introduce. Joanie Smith is a public librarian and manager of the Launchpad Makerspace at the Downtown Buffalo Central Library. Prior to completing his MLS at SUNY Buffalo in 2010, he received his Bachelor of Science in AV Production and Film Studies from SUNY Fredonia. Outside of librarianship, Jordan is on staff as a documentary film journalist for Doc NYC, which is the largest documentary film festival in the United States. He also served as founder and curator of the Buffalo-based film series Cultivate Cinema Circle. Jordan, you may begin.
Hey, everybody. Thank you, Caitlin, for the lovely introduction. And thanks for inviting me to do this, and to Jacob for asking me if I would be interested in doing this. It's been a while since I've had the opportunity to really talk about what we do here in the sphere of librarianship. Most of my job is working directly with patrons, so it's nice to talk about it in the context of libraries in general. I recognize some names in the chat, but not everybody. So welcome and thank you for being here. So I've been a public librarian for about 10 years now, a little over 10 years. And I started my career here at the Buffalo and Erie County Public Library in what's called the Techno Lab, which is our computer training department here at Central. We actually teach just general computer use and technology usage for anyone who wants to learn about it. And we do that throughout Erie County at all 37 branches. And the idea of putting together a makerspace here at Central started kind of to percolate, I want to say in 2013-14. In 2014, we very seriously started to do research on what that might look like and what the possibilities could be. We went to a number of conferences. And when I say we, I mean me and at the time my supervisor, Kara Stock, and also Dan Caulfield, who is my current boss and I think is actually here in the chat somewhere. But we started going to conferences like Computers in Libraries in DC and more local based meetups and presentations about what people are starting to offer. And then just researching what other large city branches are doing across the country. And it really varies a lot. And as we kind of go through this, you'll see what I mean. So this is the launch pad. It started as our magazine room. And before it was the magazine room, it was a little bookstore, like our used discarded bookstore in Central. And this ended up being kind of the ideal space within Central that made the most sense. It's actually right next to Borrower Services and right across from one of the main reference desks in Central. So it is a high traffic area. At the time, we were right across from a cafe. There's a cafe just across the way. Unfortunately, it has since closed, but people still hang out and there is a lot of foot traffic since we are really close to the entrance of the building. And you can see it's not a huge space. The space itself, it does have two smaller rooms within it. So we have converted those spaces into recording studios. And then we also have a staff only kind of office for storage. And also that's where I am right now, where my desk is. And then we have actually also expanded a little bit outside the room, and we'll get to that later on. So as I said, We actually opened up the room in 2015. So we have actually been around for 7 years, or almost 7 years, which is kind of crazy. We still have people come in the building and are like, how long has this been here? And when I tell them we've been here for almost 7 years, they're like, how do I not know it's here? So we're constantly bringing in new people, which is good. As I said, we replaced the former magazine room. The magazines have been shifted to the back of the building. And the space itself originally was funded by just repurposing some internal funding within Central's general funding. And the initial plan was to utilize about $20,000 to purchase equipment and renovate some of the rooms. We had to install new doors and windows and stuff like that for the studios. We have to buy new computers. We'll go through some of the equipment that we have. At this point, we have a pretty decent collection of offerings for people. But $20,000 sounds like a lot of money, but it goes extremely quick, as I'm sure you might guess. So this is what it looked like in 2015, minus the fact that we didn't have a big TV there. We've only gotten the TV in the last couple of years. During the pandemic, we did do kind of an aesthetic refresh. We created a new logo that's more suitable for multiple purposes. It's a little more punchy. As you can see, the original design was almost kind of like 90s Nickelodeon inspired, which in a lot of ways makes sense, but it also created some confusion for patrons as to what the room actually was. A lot of patrons assumed it was kind of a children's space, but actually that isn't true. We declare it to be an all ages space, although I think the large majority of what makes our space special is that it is more of a space geared toward adults, unlike a lot of the rest of the programming stuff that we do throughout the building. So I'm really proud of that. And just to do a quick comparison again, this is the old version, and this is what it looks like today. So a little cleaner. And it's an actual logo that we can use on different things as a marketing tool. So some of the services that we offer here, as I said, we have two recording studios. We have three 3D printers. We have a laser cutter. Our kind of newest and most exciting recent addition is the seed library. We've been getting a lot of new traffic and people that had not previously been coming in specifically to visit the seed library. We have a home media conversion station so people can come in for converting their home movies, whether that is on Super 8 or High 8 or Digital 8 or Mini DV or VHS. Any of those formats can be converted into a digital format. You can do color correction with the software we have offered. And also you can do video editing. So if you wanted to take old home movies that are filled with all kinds of glitches and weird edits, you can clean all that stuff up and make it into something really incredible for kind of like a home record. And I've done some editing of old home footage, which has been a really fun project, and worked with some patrons on older film stuff that they've brought in. I especially love seeing what people have on their old Super 8. It looks so cool. We also offer craft supplies, access to sewing machines. We have a weekly sewing and knitting and crocheting meetup called Stitch Circle. That is on Saturdays. And we also do one-on-one tech training for a variety of the services we offer. So not only do we show people how to do like home media conversion, but we also show people how to do studio video shooting, how to set up lighting, how to do video editing, audio recording, basic photo editing. So how to use Photoshop, Lightroom. We do how to use 3D printers, both the introductory 3D design, and also how to just navigate the printing software itself. And then also laser cutting. So a super wide range of one-on-one topics that people could come in and use and have access to. And I see there is a question in the chat. Does the Launchpad have a library of things collection? That's a great question. We actually have that on our agenda for what we are planning to do this summer and fall. In the fall, we are hoping to actually launch a library of things, mostly music gear related, but that's due to what we kind of have in the room in general. But we've slowly been collecting stuff over the last year and are continuing to do so. And as we see how our system works, we plan to expand that. So it's definitely on our list of coming attractions. We currently have at Central, we have some items that are allowed to leave the building. So we have some like science kits, astrology kits. We started recently lending Chromebooks and a variety of other stuff. So it's the systems are kind of in place, but these are going to be higher ticket items. So there will be probably a little bit more stipulation involved. Good question. Just to give you kind of an idea of how many people we are servicing in a given year, this is what it looked like right before the pandemic. We had almost 11,000 active visitors. That means someone came into the room and actively did an activity or used some of the technology, whether that means they did a digital puzzle on one of the iPads, or they were doing digital illustration with Photoshop or using some of the music gear that we have. It could be any of those kinds of things, using the 3D printers. One-on-one training. So those are individual sessions where we sit with an individual and go over the topic of choice that they want to go through. Almost 350 trainings. That's like astronomical numbers in comparison to what it is now, but things are definitely ramping back up. As a comparison, you can see this was last year. So we have about half the numbers as it was before the pandemic. But last year also was not obviously a cakewalk. So we were closed for part of it. We had staff outages. People were kind of paranoid about coming into the library at all still. We had to wear masks. We didn't have to wear masks. So it's just now kind of feeling like it's getting back to normal. We've got tours coming back in. We have a lot of foot traffic coming back in, especially now that it's getting warmer. Lots of people, not as many as we had before, but it is what it is. These are our current open hours. So we are open all the exact same hours as the library itself. Sunday hours will change for the summer. We are closed at Central during the summer, but otherwise we are open quite a lot and people can utilize anything and everything in the room between those hours. So a lot of accessibility. So our current staffing situation includes me. I am a full-time manager. I also oversee the techno lab at this point. So I'm not as involved, but I supervise and help out when necessary. We also have two part-time technical specialists, which means 19 hours a week. They are the two staff members that are also allowed to do one-on-one appointments, trainings. We have a technical clerk, and we have two senior pages. And the senior pages also are shared throughout the building, as am I, actually. I work the desk sometimes, answer the phone sometimes, I manage a collection. So I also do trainings for the techno lab. So I'm all over the place a little bit, but it's been good. I'm thankful to have the opportunity to do what I do on a daily basis. So this is our staff before the pandemic. This is just right before. And we are only short two of these people. So basically we still have the same staff. And I'm really honestly very thankful for that too, because staffing, if there's one thing that I would say about Makerspaces, is that staffing them with knowledgeable, passionate people is the number one thing that you need to be able to do. And thankfully, I feel like we've been kind of successful in that here. But we will talk about some recommendations as we go along. This is our studio number two. It was the main room that we originally had opened when we first introduced the launch pad. And in Studio 2, we have obviously a green screen. We recently did get this giant paper roll, kind of traditional fold down green screen for video and photo shooting. There's also two other color paper rolls that people can use. So we have white and black as well. And then we also have lighting and diffusers and sound deflection pads and also acoustic treatment on the wall. You can see a little bit of it in this photo, but in the next couple photos, you'll see on the other walls, it's a little more intense. We also have keyboards and a modular synth in the studio for people. If I scroll around, this is what our current desktop looks like. So we have two Mac Pros, so one in each studio. These are super high-end production computers. I'm really thankful that we were able to upgrade the computers just a few months ago, actually. So these are not the original computers that we bought when we first opened the space. And we were able to fund these system upgrades with some grant money that we got through a research program that we're currently working on. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later. So on each production desk, we have a Mac, we have a multi-purpose interface, so you can put SD cards or USB sticks or external hard drives. Run them all direct for any kind of software that you might be needing access to. And then we also have an audio interface. This is a pretty nice desktop interface called an Apollo Twin, made by Universal Audio. Highly recommend. It sounds great. It works great as a preamp. They're a little pricey, but very reliable so far. And then we also have a microphone, and that is an AKG 420, I think, if I remember it correctly. It's a condenser microphone. It's mostly designed for working in radio, but it works great for singing and stuff like that, which is singing, rapping, podcasting, all that stuff. It is totally fine for. This is Studio One, our second studio. It was kind of a storage closet, and we popped a desk in there, put up acoustic treatment. and there's a digital drum set in there for people to use. And it's got the same exact computer and keyboard in there. Otherwise, it's exactly the same. It's just smaller. Generally, it's a little quieter, I think, because the room is smaller, but the other room is more geared toward video. So it just depends on what people want to use the rooms for. As far as software on the computers, the main draw is kind of Adobe. We have the full Adobe Creative Suite. So Photoshop, InDesign, After Effects, Dreamweaver, Lightroom, all that kind of stuff. And then the thing probably that gets the most usage is GarageBand. It's an introductory software that comes free on any Mac, but it is super powerful. It sounds great. There is a lot of nice user-friendly options within it. And then if people get comfortable with GarageBand, we often recommend that they jump up to Logic Pro X or 10, which is kind of GarageBand on steroids. It's like a studio professional level version of GarageBand. It's got a lot more bells and whistles and way more control. And then in addition to those, we have purchased a variety of software plugins for production and mixing tools. A lot of people that come in want to have really great sounding stuff, but don't necessarily know a lot about how to get it that far. So a lot of the plugins that we've purchased are very user-friendly and great educational tools for teaching people about how to actually mix and master and stuff like that. Next, we have iMovie, which is similar to GarageBand in that it's free and very introductory for people doing video production. And then Final Cut Pro is similarly like Logic. It's a more professional version of video editing in the vein of iMovie, but a lot more bells and whistles and control. And we do trainings on all that stuff. Let's see. Just checking to make sure there's no questions over here. And then most recently, as far as software goes, we added AutoCAD and Inventor. And these are 3D design programs for creating products, prototyping products, or just doing 3D design for objects that you want to print on our printers or cut on our laser cutters. Prior to that, we were often sending people to use a variety of free 3D modeling softwares like SketchUp or my brain is blanking. There's a online CAD website it's okay, but it doesn't offer a ton in terms of customizability. So Tinkercad, yes, Jay, you are correct, Tinkercad. but AutoCAD and Inventor are like professional grade software for doing 3D design, and also troubleshooting and fixing any errors, like technical errors in models that you might find online. A lot of people come in and just download models, which is totally fine. We encourage people to do that. But sometimes they're not well designed, and you can use these software to correct any errors in a model that a person might find. As I said, this is kind of some of the equipment on offer in the studios. Over the years, we have upgraded some of it, replaced some of it, gotten donations for some equipment. I've spent a lot of time during the pandemic reaching out to companies to try to see if they would hook us up with free stuff. And surprisingly, a lot of people have hooked us up with free stuff. So in the studios, people can book up to 4 hours a week. We do require that they either have a library card with internet access or that they have a photo ID showing us that they're 17 or older and can prove their contact information. And then in addition to that, people can have more time if someone does not show up for their appointment or the room is just not booked at that time. And that doesn't count toward their 4 hours that they have reserved. So in the main room, we've got a wide variety of stuff. And this kind of rotates out depending on what programs we're running or what events are happening in the building or whether there's kids out on school break or something like that or summer vacation. So depending on what's going on, some stuff might be out, some stuff might not be out, but patrons can always just request whatever they want to use. So we have button makers, we have a bunch of different synth stuff. We have the conversion station, as I mentioned. We've got some coding and robotics kits. So Cosmos, Dash, Spheros, B-Bots, Ozobots, Drawbots, so all kinds of robots. And then just traditional kind of blocks and building related stuff. We have a giant bin of Kiva blocks that kind of live out there now on one of the tables and get a ton of use. And obviously Legos, a fan favorite forever and always. And then we also have sewing machines and craft supplies. And as I said, the seed library. So this is what some of the synth stuff in the back of the room that's on offer. And this stuff is out and available for people to use. Anyone can just walk up and ask to use it. All the staff have been trained to have a basic understanding and be able to explain to people how to use it. A lot of this stuff requires quite an time investment, not to mention a significant financial investment to get to a point of comfort. So my main goal with this kind of stuff is access. As a kid, I didn't have access to stuff like this. I would have loved to. One, I didn't really have a great understanding that it existed and that you can use it to make music. And also, how does it work? And without having one at home or having someone in your life that has one of these, you don't really have access. So being able to come to the library and get your hands on it, spend free time, as much free time as you want to learn it and have fun with it is a really exceptional thing. And I'm really stoked to see people using it, and it gets used on a daily basis. So it's fun. I'm really stoked about that. You can see a lot of people come in with little kids, parents come in. And if a parent is musically oriented, oftentimes they will sit with their little kid and get them to tinker around with some of the stuff, which is always super cool. But we also have four guitars, and those get used every day as well. We have little headphone amps and guitar pedals and stuff, so people can sit in the room and just play guitar for hours at a time if they want to do that. This is our seed library. People can take up to 4 packets of seeds whenever they stop in. We have garnered quite a selection of donated seeds from a bunch of different companies. We've also purchased some seeds. We've done some outreach events where we take seeds with us. We also have hosted like plant swap events. Just 2 weeks ago, we did a tree and shrub giveaway, so people could come in and just take native trees home to plant saplings. But we've got a wide variety of vegetables, fruits, herbs, flowers. It is organized alphabetically by category. And then each packet has, depending on how many seeds we get, a handful of seeds and a label giving you kind of like a outline of what it is, general instructions on how to care for it. And then, as I said, it is free to take stuff. we do call it a seed library in hopes that some people will bring back seeds after they've successfully grown stuff. And we actually have had quite a few people bring a significant amount of seeds back. So many, so actually, that depending on what it is, we've had too many because we literally don't have enough time to sort the seeds. Because seed sorting is quite a time investment, just an FYI. Thankfully, we have a few volunteers that have regularly helped us do that. But it definitely, this whole system, including ordering, organizing, creating all the packaging and sorting all the seeds and creating promotional materials for it all, and then keeping track of what goes out and how much we're going to need coming up is quite a time investment. I'm really stoked that it works well and people are excited about it, but it has been quite complicated to get going. Thankfully, I have employee Amanda, who has kind of taken this up as her main project, and she's done an amazing job with it. So super popular. This is the expanded space. You can see we are right kind of lining the side of our cafe area here, but we expanded the room out to back where the glass wall display is there. We've moved our 3D printers out there, as well as our laser cutter and Cricut machine. The reason being, when they were in the main space, these spaces were not designed to be recording studios originally, so they are definitely not soundproof. They're not horrible, but they are not soundproof. And when the 3D printers and laser cutters were going, they were a major disturbance for anyone trying to do some recording. So they are now far away from the recording studios and no longer are a problem in that sense. Not only that, but the laser cutter can be quite smelly. So it is good to have it out of the main room, kind of over by itself. depending on what people are cutting, it can be kind of gross. We'll talk about laser cutting a little bit more later. But this is more over in the space that's expanded. So you can see we have our 3D printers against the wall. We have a 3D scanner, although I can't recommend the 3D scanner. It doesn't do a great job. We have a computer setup for doing just like general computer use one-on-one appointments. And then we have our Cricut machine, you can see on the left-hand side. And out of frame is our Glowforge Pro laser cutter. All right, so as far as 3D printers, we have three. We have two Prusas and one Lulzbot. We previously had two MakerBots that have since bit the dust. We do require that people take a 45-minute training to have a grasp of what 3D printing is, how to safely use the machines, and some general use recommendations so they have more likely success with their prints than failures. Although I always tell people when they do 3D printing appointments that 3D printing is inherently a trial and error process, and you should expect multiple failures before you get a successful print. And I don't think that people really grasp that until they're doing it and don't get a successful print multiple times in a row. Question, is the training an in-person class or a recording they have to watch? So at one point we did have an online training that they could take. Unfortunately, that training is no longer applicable because we recently changed the software we were using to manage our printers. Because we do work with two different brands of printers, this was not intended, it just kind of ended up like this. we had to switch brands of software to make it compatible with multiple printers. So because we were doing it a different way previously, the training that we had developed online no longer worked. So it is completely in person at this point. At some point, I hope to get it back up online. But that means documenting everything in video form and then recreating the system for getting people to verify that they've completed the training. So there's a lot of steps involved, unfortunately, but at some point. Another question, is the training 3D printer design software, or is it training only focused on how to operate the printer? That's a good question. So our training that we require is basically focused on the printer, how to operate it, and navigate the printing software. So as far as design goes, we do offer like introductory Tinkercad training and access to AutoCAD, but we don't have any real experts on how to navigate AutoCAD. Like, we've tinkered with it ourselves and like have a basic understanding of it, but I don't feel comfortable enough to train people on it. As Caitlin said in the beginning, my background's actually in audio production and film studies. So before I was a librarian, I was working in radio and playing in bands. And I just happened to come upon a job that kind of really suited my interests here at the library. And so in some of the technology that we offer, I have had a significant learning curve, such as 3D printing, laser cutting. I had never used these things before. So, and a lot of people that work here also had never used them before. So there is a lot of staff training and time investment in making sure that people have the skill sets to both use the stuff, but also show patrons how to use the stuff. And that comes back to staffing, which again, we'll talk about in a little bit. Good question. So here's our Lulzbot. It is the bigger of the three printers and generally the most reliable. One of our Prusas is currently down, but I can't say we haven't had a printer with any that has successfully lived its life without any massive meltdowns. Every single one of them has had some kind of massive problem where we had to deconstruct it and replace major parts of it. 3D printing is, it requires a lot of troubleshooting. Laser cutting. So the laser cutter we got, a Glowforge Pro, I want to say right before the pandemic. And a Glowforge is a large desktop laser cutter that can cut wood, it can cut acrylic, it can cut a wide variety of stuff, and also engrave. And again, we do offer a 45-minute training on how to essentially navigate the software and do it safely. Both the 3D printer and Glowforge can, in theory, be dangerous, both from like a, you can hurt yourself, but you can also potentially start a fire. So obviously neither one of these things is wanted in the public library. So making sure that patrons are following procedures and have a great understanding of how to avoid those problems is critical. We have had a couple patrons who, even after taking the training with us, kind of refused to follow procedure, and we've had to not so subtly tell them that they were not allowed to use the printers anymore because they are not following instructions. So it is something you do have to monitor. Another question, for 3D printing, do you allow patrons to bring their own PLA or materials? No, unfortunately. We have thought about that, but one of the greatest issues that we've run into with 3D printers is if you change the filament frequently, it is significantly more likely to get jammed. And the settings are very finicky depending on the material type and even the material brand. Like even if you have the same brand of material, a different color might require slightly different settings to get the print to work properly. So if you allowed patrons to bring random brands and random material types in to use on your machines, you're going to do a lot of troubleshooting more than you already are doing, which is not great. Good question, though. These are just some examples of stuff that we've printed. We've done puzzles, we've done all kinds of gift items that people have made, portraits on wood, and I made my own little synth case for at home. All kinds of stuff, tons of stuff. We offer a wide variety of programming, like where we plan out a guided activity with people. Just for time's sake, I'm gonna kind of scan through these. We've got some photos of flower pressing because we have a beautiful garden out front in Central. We did a few different flower pressing programs and collage programs. We work with Go Bike Buffalo and offer tutorials on how to do bike work, repair work. And they would just offer like help for people that just needed like a quick fix it. Take apart programs where people learn how to take apart and put back together computers. We do have VR headsets for people to use. We are actually today hosting the Boys and Girls Club for one of a series of programs on digital painting in virtual reality. So that gets used quite a lot when we're working with some of the community groups. Which takes us to partnerships. And one of the things that has made us really successful is working directly with outside organizations to bring people in. We do work with a lot of local schools, bringing in tours, doing teacher programs where we teach teachers how to use software so they can pass that knowledge on to their students and let them know that it's available at the library for free. As I said, the Boys and Girls Clubs come in, Go Bike Buffalo. We Make Buffalo is kind of like a loose organization of local maker organizations in Buffalo. And we would meet regularly before the pandemic to kind of let each other know what we're working on so we're not stepping on each other's toes, and also sharing resources to an extent. There is a local organization that provides free art supplies for kids, so that's Art Coves. And then we also would host a regular, well, once a year robotics competition called Vex Robotics here, and they would do their competition as part of the Makerspace. We are currently getting funding from mainly our internal budget. So my equipment budget is about $10,000 or $12,000 a year. And that's shared between both the Launchpad and Technolab. So any kind of computer upgrades or software purchases or any kind of equipment, any kind of supplies, whether that means paint or paper or pencils or anything like that, all that comes out of the same pool of money. And then we have been really lucky to secure some grants. We, for the last 3 years, have been working with UB on a project called the Assessment for Learning in Library Makerspaces. And they are essentially doing research on how to prove that makerspaces are places that facilitate learning, because it's very obvious that people are learning in makerspaces in a variety of different ways, but it's very difficult to like scientifically prove it. So that's what they've been trying to study, And because of that, we've gotten a significant amount of money for both the research, but also for some of the equipment that we've gotten, like the computer upgrades. We also work with NASA. We've gotten a grant from them to do astronomy-based science programs. So we've been doing that. We've also worked with Google in the past. We do have a partnership with Grow with Google, which is their computer training online department. And then, as I said before, I did reach out to a lot of different companies over the pandemic and was successfully able to get a lot of companies to donate equipment. So we've gotten like drum machines and synthesizers and guitar pedals and software totally free. Just companies are like, wow, you guys are doing cool stuff. We would love to help you out with some stuff. And they just send it to us, which has been amazing. And a lot of that equipment is going to be used in that lending library that we're talking about. Caitlin asks, I was wondering what kind of companies you reached out to for equipment. Were they local? No, because I do have a lot of like personal interest in just like music gear. I'm kind of a nerd when it comes to that kind of stuff. I essentially like I'm just very knowledgeable as like what companies are out there doing cool stuff, and just reached out to them. I could whip up a list of some of the companies I would recommend talking to. I'm currently talking to a company called Teenage Engineering. They're based in Sweden, but they are gonna hook us up with some deep discounts on some of their cheaper products that I'd like to put in our lending library. So it just depends on what you're asking for and what you intend to use it for. A lot of people just wanna know. Yeah, Teenage Engineering are super cool. They make a lot of cool stuff. And just in the last week, they've announced a couple really insane, awesome pieces of gear. Not cheap, but very cool. As far as promotion, I would say this is kind of the biggest hurdle that we have, is trying to get our program out there into the community, because when people think library, they do not think recording studios and 3D printers and laser cutters. So outreach is kind of one of the main avenues for that. We do a lot of outreach. We go to maker fairs and community events and anything that makes sense. Just over the weekend, we did an outreach program at the Massachusetts Avenue Project, which is a urban farm here in Buffalo. The week before, I was at the Western New York Maker Fair. All summer, we're going to go to Canal Side and do tabling and do craft programs and equipment demos. So outreach is really critical for us. Over the pandemic, we started doing more online programming. So we have a Discord. We offer like 1 hour trainings on a variety of topics. We've kind of scaled that back as things have gotten back to normal, but at the time it was really a great way to reach out to people. Obviously the traditional flyers and posters, but not just in the building. I am a firm believer in random encounters in the community. And one of the only random encounters people are gonna have are posters. If you're at the grocery store, you walk in and generally there's gonna be a community board there. And I see and find out about all kinds of random stuff that I would have never thought of unless I encountered the poster there, and someone had to deliver it there. So someone's got to be going out and delivering the stuff in the community. So once in a while, I would say like probably every 2 months, I try to get out of the building and just put up flyers, distribute our brochures in places that I know, accept that kind of stuff. It's a hard thing to gauge the success of, but I really am a firm believer that it is like a critical thing to do. Social media obviously is a really great avenue for reaching out into the community in a digital way. We currently do not have our own channel. We are kind of umbrellaed under the main library. I don't necessarily think that's the best model, but it is how we operate at the moment. And then partnering with other social media influencers is helpful. So recently we partnered with Step Out. We've had a lot of traffic just from them posting about programs we're doing, spaces in the building like the Launchpad that you might not be familiar with. So finding people that are willing to kind of share what you're doing is also really helpful. And then recently we've had, I mean, occasionally you'll see us like on Channel 4, Channel 7, doing kind of like a guest TV spot. But we've also had a couple interviews in local magazines too. So I did an interview in Buffalo Spree, and Amanda did an interview about the Seed Library in Edible Western New York. So just talking to media outlets with press releases and having a relationship with them can be really good. Significant ways to reach out. Here's a couple of our brochures. So the launch pad and then some of the stuff we offer. I am also a firm believer that if you're going to have materials, that it must look super professional. So we spent a lot of time developing the aesthetic look that we currently have and the promotional materials that we have. And I'm really proud of them. Thanks to my coworker, Shane, who's a really good graphic designer. So that's our Seed Library brochure. This is an outreach from the Western New York Maker Faire the other day. So when we go out, we take some equipment, we take a bunch of brochures and materials. We have craft make and take bags or take and make bags. This is one of the online programs that we did over the past year where I basically taught a class on the basics of how to use a modular synth and concepts involved in it. This is the interview in which Amanda was interviewed about the Seed Library. And then recommendations. So if you are thinking about starting a makerspace, or you have a space where you're doing maker activities already and you want to expand upon that, these are some of the things I would definitely think about. Base your offerings on staff skill sets. So we offer a very wide variety of stuff here, and we have a pretty small staff. That said, each of the staff members we have has a very, very different knowledge base and interest in specific topics. So I generally do most of the audio production, video production, trainings. And if someone comes in, they have specific questions about that stuff, generally they get directed to me. If another staff is asked about it, everyone is able to talk about it. But if you get deep into it, you're going to need to talk to me. The same goes for if you want to do something with our Cricut and you have a lot of questions about the Cricut, I'm going to direct you to Amanda because Amanda knows way more about the Cricut than I do. I have a basic understanding of it and I know how to use it. But if you have a lot of questions about it, Amanda's going to be the person. So make sure that you are hiring people that have a passion for the things that you're wanting to offer. When I'm interviewing people, one of the questions I always ask is, outside of your professional life, what kind of creative endeavors do you have? Because that's going to be a kind of your entryway into what they might be able to offer as far as creativity goes. Creativity is like the key factor here in one of these spaces. You have to have creative people. Develop systems that work for you. Now, all the stuff that I've talked about is all outward facing stuff. All the training and documentation and statistical tracking, all that stuff has to be accounted for. And all of them are going to be specialized to what you need from them. So it's it's something you probably won't think about right up front, but it's definitely something you're gonna need to do. Again, plan for lots of staff training. There's lots of staff in the building. There's lots of staff at other branches. Sometimes when people call in, someone from a different part of the building is gonna have to staff the room. And they have to have a basic understanding of all of the stuff in here. And it's not gonna be ideal, but there's only so many staff, unfortunately. And we have to be open all the time. Think creatively about the usage of space. A lot of the stuff we have on offer is on some kind of mobile furniture. So when we need it to be out of the way, we can move it. So almost everything is on wheels. All the tables can be reconfigured to be used for something else. Start small and mobile. That is one of the main recommendations that we took away from when we started researching. I would say we have an advantage in that we had more financial investment up front than a lot of people are going to be able to give to something like this. And additionally, with my involvement, my background in some of the AV stuff was really helpful in developing what we ended up doing here. Whereas a lot of libraries don't have a staff member on hand that has like a background in that. But all staff is gonna have their own interests, and that can be used as an advantage. And where you don't have a good knowledge base on a specific topic, the internet is gonna be your friend. I can't tell you how many hours I've spent on the internet trying to troubleshoot issues with the 3D printers or the laser cutter. Utilize it. And then if you can, find volunteers or patrons that are also super knowledgeable. We've had volunteers in the past. A lot of makerspaces like solely run on volunteers. Based on how the library operates, it's harder for us to do that. But it's something to think about if you're a smaller system. This is kind of my main thought about what we do here. Access is everything. All of the technology that we offer is generally kept behind a paywall for most people. Equipment is expensive, schooling is expensive, access is expensive. So we're just making it available to anyone who wants it. And that's the main goal. So if we can do that with as many different avenues as possible, that's what I'm hoping to do. That said, if you're looking at it from a staffing perspective, staff over staff, meaning if you're planning a makerspace, you need to plan to have staff that know what they're doing. If you don't have staff that are knowledgeable enough to tell and teach other people, just offering the stuff is not going to be enough. So you got to find a balance of offering stuff that people want to use with staff that are able to teach people how to use it. So in my opinion, it's a very key thing to have a balance between those things. So with that, I think that's all I've got for you. Obviously I'm here if you guys have questions. Oh, look at that. It is exactly 3:00. I can't believe I timed that so well. Look at that. I'm proud of myself.
Thank you, Jordan. This was a great presentation. If anyone wants to stay on and ask Jordan some questions that he didn't cover, please feel free to put them in the chat now. If not, we will wrap up. I'll just give everyone a minute to think about it.
Well, if there's no questions, I appreciate everybody listening, and hopefully this is helpful. It's fun to talk about. I I am really proud of the space that we've been able to create here. And
yeah, it's fantastic.
To share the knowledge.
Okay, it looks like you have covered everything that everyone wanted to know. But if you do think of questions, you can email me and I will relay it to Jordan, or you can contact him at the email on the screen. Thank you everyone for coming. Thank you, Jordan, for presenting. And thank you, Jacob, and the rest of the RingUXCE committee for putting this presentation together. I hope you have a great rest of the day.
Yeah. Thanks, everybody.